Michelle.
Hi.
So I have a couple of questions, and so I'll make them quickly so we can get in on the time. The first thing that I wanted to ask you about was your question about justice concerning God and Christ's death on the cross. The thing that just I'm wondering from your perception is that Christ did become sin for us because it was he that knew no sin that became sin so that we may become the righteousness in God. But there was a choice that he made. God had him set aside as a substitution for our sin, but Jesus went to the cross willingly. So that whole idea of God putting his son to death, his son tread up that hill carrying that cross in his own strength.
Can I interrupt you for there a little bit? Okay, so think about, did Jesus really have a choice? Jesus could have said no. Here he was born, here he was God, became man, and he could have said no?
I believe he could have. Yes, I
so,
do.
I mean, didn't God know what he was doing from the foundation of the world?
Oh, I believe God did know what he was doing, and I also believe God from the foundation of the world in the Garden of Eden saw man as a perfect being in perfect communion with him.
I know, but I mean...
But he had free will as well.
So but to say that he came from heaven, born of the Virgin, and became a man and decided, oh, I'm not going to go through with this.
Well, I guess I'm pointing my question back at you to say... How can that whole idea of justice come about when someone does something willingly? That analogy you gave of a person mm-hmm. out here committing murder mm-hmm. and someone willingly stepping forward and saying, mm-hmm. I'm going to pay the price for that man.
Right, right.
Okay, so I guess my sense of justice and yours is a little bit different because...
Well, if you're the judge, you would... let's say there was a murderer here, and his father says, I love my kid so much, he's convicted murderer, but so please kill me instead. As a judge, you would do that?
As a judge, I don't feel like I would have the ability to make that judgment. Just as Ben said, I feel like in the examples that we're talking about today concerning Christ and his substitution death for us, mm-hmm. that God is a righteous judge. None of us can stand up and say that we are without unrighteousness. So that precludes us from being able to make those kinds of judgments. But I will say this, if what I don't feel I also would have the right to do is to say to that person that is saying, I'm willing to lay my life down for this other person, no matter what the circumstance is, I don't think I would have the judgment to be able to say, you can't or cannot do that. That's that person's own free will.
But I thought you said as a judge, you wouldn't accept that.
That's what I'm saying. As a judge, I would not have the right to make that judgment.
Well, but you know, you have to, no, you contest, do have the, but you do have the right. That's your responsibility to make a judgment, a
no,
penalty.
I would not be able to say to him, you can take that person's place. That's the judgment I would be.
But why not? Because you have the power to condemn this person to death. Murderer, you're sentenced to death. And somebody else says, no, I'll do it for you. So either way, you're gonna make a judgment
well,
of somebody dying.
There's laws that are set in place in the court of law that I think would preclude me from being able to act on
that. Yeah, and the reason why is because it would be immoral to do that.
So I just wanted to hear what your thoughts were on Christ willingly and how mm-hmm. that, you know, comes into play from putting God off that seat mm-hmm. of injustice.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
Christ did willingly go.
Right, right. And I don't think it makes any difference.
Okay. And then my other question, very quickly, is when you guys were debating about this idea of oughtness and flourishing, what came to my mind is that, and I think this is what Ben was saying, is that in order for you to set up this standard of what flourishing is, there has to be a standard, right?
Well, okay, first off, we're out of time, so you can summarize, we'll just make this really brief. I'm not saying it's a standard. I'm saying more it's a definition. Morality is about flourishing. That's by definition.
But if I say I'm going to flourish, I have to have a standard by means of what that would look like.
Yeah, but you know what flourishing means, don't you? Flourishing, it's just the word. It just means you're doing the best you can. And that's the goal.
Okay.
It's not a technical word. It's not a hard word to grasp.
No, flourishing's not, but I'm saying there has to be a standard within each person of what flourishing means. Because what you might think is flourishing and what I might think is flourishing might be two separate things.
But that's a good discussion. And if we both agree that it's about flourishing, then we get together and we hash it out. What's the best thing?
Okay, so where does your standard for flourishing come from?
It's not a standard, it's just a definition. We might have different ideas of what's flourishing in a situation, but that's just something we talk about. But at least we're on the same ground versus a Christian who might say, my morality is called divine command ethics, which means God says it and I do it. I don't think about it. I don't think about flourishing. I don't think about anything. I just, what's written, that's how I do it. I don't use my brain.
See, that's just it. For a Christian, myself being one, I think of all kinds of things in God's word that tells me what I ought to do. But there's times where I choose not to do that. And it's not because God doesn't have this set of standards for me that would equate to flourishing. It's because I have free will. I believe everything that God has in his word that is an ought would fit into your definition of flourishing. It's because he desires for us to flourish. But that's where I just get a little bit on where you come from, is that if I set my own standard of flourishing, how do I uphold that?
Okay, well, we're out of time. We're at 6 minutes now, so maybe we'll have a chance to talk more afterwards.
Secret.
Okay, thanks. Or somebody, and somebody else can follow up on your thoughts too. Okay, so Brendan wanted to, we're going back and forth between atheists and Christians.